Good morning, Jerusalem. Is it well with your soul? Let me begin by first saying thank you to all of you who encouraged me during Clergy Appreciation Month and wished me happy birthday on my birthday on yesterday. I thank God for you. I do appreciate all the encouraging words, gifts, love, and just your kindness that you've shown to Miss Grant's husband. We love you, Jerusalem, and friends, and we thank you so much. As we move into a new month, we're moving even closer to what I pray will be a soon return to in-person worship. It has been much a longer time than we anticipated, and I know that you are excited to get back to fellowshipping with each other. I have truly missed our time together, but as the old folk would say, if the Lord said the same and the creek don't rise, we hope to get back together soon. Well, I want to change it up a bit and say, even if the creek rises, if the numbers go down and the Lord said the same, we still hope to see you real soon. You know, as I thought along these lines, I was still meditating on the Sunday school lesson that we had a couple of weeks ago. It was entitled Our House. And the main thought of the lesson was centered around the psalmist's excitement and gratefulness for the opportunity to worship in the house of God. Now, while that was the main thought of the lesson, it was some background material that really caught my attention. That material was found in 2 Chronicles 29. And there we find King Hezekiah making drastic reforms to restore the temple worship after the doors had been shut by prior leadership of wicked kings. Hezekiah started this reformation by getting the priests to first of all sanctify themselves, and then he charged them to clean the temple from the top to the bottom and repair what had been broken by the previous wicked kings. He then had them to reinstitute the offerings and the sacrifices that God had commanded them to obey. This led to true praise and worship among the people as they reassembled themselves to worship God in his house. Well, our doors have been shut for a different reason. Yet, as we are making preparations in hopes of returning soon, we still need to consider ourselves and where we are spiritually, and make sure that like the priests, Levites, and all the people sanctified themselves, that we do the same before we come back. Therefore, this morning, turn with me to Psalm 51. And although I want to deal with the entire passage in Psalm 51, I want to just read verse 7 this morning for our hearing. Psalm 51, verse 7. It says, purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let's pray. God, this morning we do praise you for your kindness, for your goodness, your mercy, and your grace. God, as we come, we need you to touch our lives and sanctify our hearts and our minds, that we indeed can give you true praise and worship. Bless your word as it goes forth today, O God, and give us clean hearts and hands and even minds that we can praise and serve you in a way that brings you glory, praise, and honor. Give us ears to hear, hearts to believe, and wills to carry your divine will, and we will bless your name forever. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen and amen. This morning, I want to talk about wash me, Lord, because I need your help. Wash me, Lord, because I need your help. Sister Margaret Pleasant DeRoe has written a number of beautiful hymns and spiritual songs for the body of Christ for a long time. Many of her songs have been sung by church choirs, performed by great solo artists, and have been taught in many workshops, particularly the Gospel Music Workshop of America. One of these songs that she wrote has always been a favorite of mine, and it's one that I often hear my wife singing around the house. It's entitled, Give Me a Clean Heart. The words say, give me a clean heart so I may serve thee. Lord, fix my heart so that I can be used by thee. For I am not worthy of all these blessings. So Lord, give me a clean heart and I'll follow thee. The words of this song gives a heartfelt desire of a penitent believer who realizes that unless God does something to his heart, then he will not be able to serve him like he should. You need to understand, my brothers and sisters, that it does not matter how well you sing, preach, or teach. It doesn't matter how much money you give or how much you claim you love the church. Unless the Lord gives you a clean heart, your service to him is in vain. The psalmist said in Psalm 24, verses 3 through 4, who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? He answers by saying, he that has clean hands and a pure heart. Over the years, we've heard the mantra in the church that God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. And while this is true, we must ask ourselves, who is God good to? Well, Psalm 73:1 says that God is good to all those who are of a clean heart. Therefore, it is without question that if the church is going to be effective in her work for the Lord, then her people must have clean hands and pure heart. It was our Lord Jesus who said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Well, in the narrative this morning that brings about the writing of our text, David, who God said was a man after his own heart, has found himself in a situation that has caused him to not only have trouble in his life, but also trouble with his Lord. We know all too well his story of adultery with Bathsheba, and his causing the murder of her husband Uriah, and then how the prophet Nathan exposed him of his sin. But it wasn't until David did something about his situation that he was able to get the help that he needed. And if we're going to get the help we need from the Lord, we must do the same thing David did. Now, understand, you don't have to do the same thing that David did to need some help, but you got to do what he did to get some help. Well, what did he do to get his help? And what do we have to do to get help? Well, here's my first point, and that is David acknowledged his state of messiness. That's right. He acknowledged his state of messiness. See, in order for the Lord to help us, we must first acknowledge the fact that we need him. That means I've got to acknowledge my state of messiness. I must admit that I messed up and I am messed up. In verse 3, David confessing says, for I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Yes, David acknowledged his state of messiness. Now, most of us figure that we are okay. Oh, we have no problem acknowledging that we're not perfect. But let us tell it, we're not far from it. See, admitting that we are wrong is hard to do because it's just a part of our sinful nature. And we are always inclined to deny the reality of our true state. But the Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and that there is none righteous, no, not one. Paul even admitted in Romans 7:18 that I know that there in my flesh is no good thing. You know, we also like to compare ourselves with people that we think we are not as bad as. However, the issue is not who you are not as bad as, but who you are not as good as. Think about it. And since the Bible teaches us that there is only one who is good, and that is God, and that the perfect embodiment of God is his son, Jesus Christ, and he is also good, and none of us are better than Jesus, then it won't matter if you're better than me. You nor I are as good as Jesus, and so we both are still in a mess. And so to get the help he so desperately needed, David acknowledged his state of messiness. But then, once David acknowledged his state of messiness, he then, and here's my second point, he then appealed to the mercy of God. When your plumbing is messed up, you call a plumber. When your car is messed up, you call a mechanic. When your body gets sick, you call the doctor. When you have legal issues, you call a lawyer. When you have difficulty with the school subject, you call a tutor. These are the experts that we appeal to when we need help. Now, if we call the experts to help us when life situations get the best of us, doesn't it make sense to call the only one who can help us with our sin problem? David says in verse 4, "Against you and you only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that you might be justified when you speak and clear when you judge." Listen, my brothers and sisters, if you don't ask for help, you won't get the help that you need. And that's another problem that we have, and that's asking the Lord for help. You see, we tend to think that we can handle situations ourselves and don't need any help. But we are wrong. In Psalm 32, which is a parallel passage to Psalm 51, David says in verses 3 through 6, "When I kept silent, my bones waxed old through my roaring all day long. For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture turned to the drought of summer." He said, "I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquity I have not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. For this everyone that is godly pray unto thee in a time when thou mayest be found." Yes, David appealed to God's mercy for help. Now, to appeal to the mercy of God means to lay everything before him and realize your life and all that concerns it is in God's hand. It means to place all your hope in a God who will deal with you according to his compassion and mercy, and trust him not to give you what you deserve, but to give you what you don't deserve. To appeal to his mercy means to say, "I need thee, oh, I need thee. Lord, every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come unto thee." Yes, you've got to acknowledge your state of messiness. And then you've got to appeal to the mercy of God. See, even though David had committed his sin against Bathsheba and against Uriah and as a leader against Israel, he realized that the main one he had sinned against was God. And until he got right with God, there was no way for him to be right with man. We must realize that our sins and iniquities transgress the laws of God. And we have to stand before him and give an account of our deeds one day. But here's the clincher. Until we see how what we do affects a holy God more than it does people, we will never be on the road to restoration. We must understand how what we do affects how we make God look in the world. That's why Jesus said, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven." Our lives must be an example of a life of faith before God so that he can be exalted before the world. So we must acknowledge our state of messiness. Then we must appeal to the mercy of God. The next thing David did was that, and here's my third point, we've got to accept God's method of cleansing. That's right, David had to accept God's method of cleansing. Now, I know that many of you have different brands of detergent or washing powder or whatever you use to get your clothes clean. It may be one that is a personal preference. It may be one that you persuaded to get because of their advertisement. It may be one that is the family has always used. Or it may be all the store had, or it may be all that your money will let you buy. Nevertheless, you determined what cleanser you would use. Well, when it comes to the cleansing of our sin, there's only one cleanser that will suffice. See, David is asking for a deep heart cleansing, and he uses hyssop to symbolize it because hyssop was a common cleaning agent. And it is interesting that when he says, "Wash me," he is talking about the way clothes were washed in his time, and that is with beating and pounding, not just like a little rinsing. See, David is so deeply sorry. He wants more than just a quick wash up. He wants the very desire for sin to be washed out of him. He doesn't want a rinsing off. He desires a thorough cleansing that only God can provide. Here's a question. Do we ever feel that repentant over our own sin? Do we ever feel so dirty and stained that we want God to just beat and pound us with his cleansing power that we'll hate the very thought of sin? You see, until we see sin the way God sees it, we'll never get clean. Until we despise evil the way God does, we won't get clean. Until we realize that we are not as bad as we could be, save for the grace of God, we'll never get clean. And until we realize that only God has the right cleansing agent, we'll never get clean. The songwriter wrote, "What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus." The Bible says that without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. Yes, it is only through the blood of the crucified Lamb that our sins are washed away. When Jesus came into the Jordan to be baptized, John the Baptist could declare, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world." Yes, God's method of cleansing is the blood of Christ that was shed at Calvary. You know, I like to call it Ajax, A-J-A-X. That means all Jesus at the cross. Listen, once we are cleansed by the blood of Christ, it is the Holy Spirit and the Word of God that keeps us clean. Well, finally, what do you do when God cleanses you? Well, that's simple. And here's my last point. You do what he tells you to do, and that is you apply your heart to do the will of God. That's right. You apply your heart to do the will of God. David said, "Lord, when you clean me up, then I'll teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee." You see, you can't clean anybody else up until you get cleaned up yourself. You can't take the mote out of your brother's eye until you get that beam or plank out of your own eye. You can't get somebody else straight until you get yourself straight. And the Lord is just waiting on you to turn to him and be cleaned so he can shower you with his mercy and put you on the right road to serve him. David's desire is to teach the men ways of God and to turn them to a life of faith in him. Paul, when he was chained on the Damascus road, he said, "Lord, what would you have me to do?" Isaiah, when his tongue was clean, he said, "Lord, here am I, send me." When the Lord had cleansed Zacchaeus' heart, Zacchaeus said, "Lord, the half of my goods I give. And if I have cheated anybody, I will restore to them four times what I took." Yes, my brothers and sisters, God wants to clean us up for his service. But Satan wants to keep us stained in sin. But we can't let him win and do that to us. As I closed, there was a story of a young boy who was visiting his grandparents on their farm. He was given a slingshot to play with out in the woods. And he practiced in the woods all day, but he never could hit the target. Well, he was getting a little discouraged. And as he's heading back to dinner, he's walking by and he sees Grandma's pet dove. But just out of an impulse, he let the slingshot fly. And he hit the duck square in the head and he killed it. He was shocked and he was grieved and he was scared. So in a panic, the little boy hid the dead duck in a woodpile. But his sister was on the side watching. Sally had seen it all, but she didn't say anything. Well, after lunch the next day, Grandma said, "Sally, come help me wash the dishes." But Sally said, "Grandma, Johnny told me that he want to help out in the kitchen and wash dishes." And then she whispered to Johnny, "Remember the duck?" So Johnny did the dishes. Later on that day, Grandpa asked if the children wanted to go fishing. And Grandma said, "Well, I'm sorry, but I need Sally to help me make supper." Sally just smiled and said, "Well, that's okay, because Johnny told me that he wanted to help you and I could go." And she whispered again to Johnny, "Remember the duck?" So Sally went fishing and Johnny stayed to help. Well, after several days of Johnny doing both his chores and Sally's chores, he finally couldn't stand it any longer. So he came to Grandmama and he confessed, "Grandmama, Grandmama, I'm sorry, but I killed that duck and I'm sorry, I killed the duck." Grandmama knelt down, gave him a hug, and said, "Johnny, I know, sweetheart." She said, "I was standing at the window and I saw the whole thing. But because I love you, I already forgave you. I was just wondering how long you was gonna let Sally make a slave out of you." Listen, my brothers and sisters, that's what the devil keeps doing to many of us. He has seen us do some stuff that we're ashamed of, and we don't want anybody to know about it. We are afraid of how it's going to ruin our testimony and our reputation. We are afraid of how people will see us, and we are ashamed. And although we've gone to God, Satan keeps throwing it in our faith. And when something God has for us comes along, Satan reminds us of the dead ducks in our past, and we remain in sorrow and despair. But just like Grandmama saw what happened and forgave little Johnny because she loved him and didn't want him living in a slave to fear and shame anymore, God has done the same thing for us. God has seen our past and he knows how bad it looks. He knows that we've not been very good. As a matter of fact, had it not been for his mercy and his grace, we would be worse than we are right now. But thank God, he looked beyond our faults and he saw our needs. Thank God that his mercy and his grace stayed his hand of justice against us and he took our sins upon himself. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And over 2,000 years ago, on a hill called Calvary, Jesus, the righteous Son of God, bore our sins at the cross. He took our place. He suffered for you and I. He was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. By his stripes, we are healed. The blood he shed washed away our sins. And I'm glad that the blood will never, ever lose its power. He died on the old red cross. But early Sunday morning, he had the grave of all power and authority in his hand. And listen, it doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter how long you've been doing it. God is able to wash away your sin. He can clean you up this morning and give you a new heart that you can serve him the way he wants you to. The song says, "There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stain. Just say, Lord, I need your help. I can't fix this mess that I'm in. Forgive me, Lord, of all my sins. Wash me, Lord, and make me white as snow. Create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. Lord, I want to live for you and I want to serve you. Have mercy on me, Lord, because I need your help. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you this day that we can acknowledge our state of messiness to you. We thank you that we can appeal to your mercy. And we thank you, oh God, that you have a way to cleanse us from all our sins. And then God, when you cleanse us, we thank you that you just don't throw us away, but you give us what we need to serve you. Thank you so much for the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus Christ. God, I pray that those at the sound of my voice will turn to you for salvation and even sanctification, that they can live a life that's well-pleasing in your sight. Thank you for Jesus, and thank you for the blood that washes away our sin. Wash us all, Lord, because we need your help. We're so glad that the blood will never lose its power, and we're so glad that we're saved by your grace. We thank you now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. My brothers and sisters, join me now as we share together the Lord's Supper. Betrayed, he took bread, and when he broke it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take ye, eat, this is my body that is broken for you. As often as you do it in remembrance of me." In like manner, he took the cup, and when he poured it, he gave it to them and said, "Take ye, drink ye all of it. This is my blood that is shed for me. And as often as you do it in remembrance of me." In the book of Corinthians, Paul, when he wrote his letter to the church at Corinth, reminded them that when they come together, to be sure that they discern the Lord's body, in order that they may not eat or drink damnation unto themselves. I remind you, my brothers and sisters, that none of us are worthy to come to the table of ourselves, but it is because of what Christ has done that he bids us to come and partake. Let us pray. God, we thank you now for this glorious opportunity to celebrate and observe this Lord's Supper ordinance. And as we partake in these elements that represent the broken body and the shed blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, we do so with joy and thanksgiving in our hearts. And we look forward to the return of the Lord Jesus Christ to receive his church. Bless us now, we pray, in his name. Amen. and amen. The body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that was broken for us all. Let's eat together, my brothers and sisters. And now the blood of Christ that was shed for the remission of our sins. Let's drink together, my brothers and sisters. Let us pray. God, again, we say thank you for grace and mercy. And we thank you for Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Help us, we pray, to let others see Jesus in us as we live our lives as your disciples. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. My brothers and sisters, again, as we go away, let us remember what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, our hearts have felt. And don't forget, as you go, forgive somebody, because someone needs forgiveness now. And as the opportunity presents itself, share the love of Jesus Christ with those you come in contact with. And remember, at Jerusalem, we are ministering with eternity in view.